We thought we'd start with a brief biography of Gershwin. He was born in 1898 and died in 1937. He died of a brain tumor, a metastatic brain tumor. It's really very, very sad because it didn't have the medical technology that we do today. To give you some perspective in what was going on in the world when he was alive, 1898 was the year after Brahms died, and 1939 was the year that Gone with the Wind came out. So that gives you some idea of when he was living and creating. He studied with Charles Hambitzer, Reuben Goldmark, who was a composer, Henry Cowell, I'm sure most of you know who Henry Cowell was, Joseph Brody, and Edward Kalenyi. Now this is Edward Kalenyi, or Kalenyi the senior, and he was a composer and also a pianist, but I think his son, Junior, was better known. At some point, Gershwin traveled to Paris to meet Parisians, and his music was performed. And at the same time, he approached Nadia Boulanger for lessons, and she turned him down. And I think maybe she thought that he was not worthy of, I mean, I'm just guessing, but not worthy of her attention because he wrote kind of in a jazz style. As I'm sure you know, he composed in many different genres, opera, Porgy and Bess, orchestral concertos, and songs. What probably made him so popular was that he was successful in blending classical and jazz styles. It was this versatility that, and the fact that he was a prolific composer, that he died a very wealthy man, but it just goes to show you that money can't buy health. And really it was very sad because he had so much to offer, and I mean, I think that tunes just came out of him. I mean, they just poured out of him. He didn't work hard. I mean, he had things to say, and probably had things to say up until the end of his life. The history of Rhapsody in Blue is that it was commissioned by Paul Whiteman, who was a leader of a very popular dance band. Gershwin originally declined Whiteman's request to write a concerto for jazz piano and orchestra. Months later, Ira, George's brother, was reading in the newspaper about this upcoming concert called An Experiment in Modern Music, and he read that George was going to compose a piece for the concert. And so he immediately drew George's attention to this newspaper article, and George said, oh, I didn't agree to do that. But he said, okay, I'll do it, and so he hurriedly started writing. But George was really, really busy, so he didn't have much time to write things down. The eventual, what came of that was kind of a two-piano score, but so much of what he did at the piano during the premiere was improvisatory. So he had told the conductor, Whiteman, to just wait for a nod to know when to bring the orchestra back in. So it was, I mean, I'm sure he was up there, you know, doing his thing, and people were just guessing. Let's see, as I said, the premiere of the work was February 12th, 1924, and the reviews of the premiere were really mixed. I have three of them here. I'd like to share them with you. They're relatively short, but they're very interesting. Olden Downs of the New York Times wrote, of the premiere, this composition shows extraordinary talent, as it shows a young composer with aims that go far beyond those of his ilk, struggling with a form of which he is far from being a master. In spite of all this, he has expressed himself in a significant and, on the whole, highly original form. Now the next one is really harsh. Lawrence Gilman, New York Tribune, February 1924. How trite, feeble, and conventional the tunes are. How sentimental and vapid the harmonic treatment under its disguise of fussy and futile counterpoint. Weep over the lifelessness of the melody and harmony. So derivative, so stale, so inexpressive. Ooh. And then many, many years later, Leonard Bernstein wrote an article about Rhapsody in Blue for the Atlantic Monthly. This is 1955, okay. The Rhapsody is not a composition at all. It's a string of separate paragraphs stuck together. The themes are terrific, inspired, God-given. I don't think there's been such an inspired melodist on this earth since Tchaikovsky. But if you want to speak of a composer, that's another matter. Your Rhapsody in Blue is not a real composition in the sense that whatever happens in it must seem inevitable. You can cut parts of it without affecting the whole. You can remove any of these stuck together sections and the piece still goes on as bravely as before. It can be a 5-minute piece or a 12-minute piece. And in fact, all these things are being done to it every day. And it's still the Rhapsody in Blue.
So here we have consulted with different sources, and there might be some minor differences, but we came up with all these 6 themes. So here I'm just going to walk you through all of them. The first one, ritornello. Distribution. So here is a similar passage in primo and secondo, but we both handle the technique differently. So if you look at the bottom right, so where I take that accent and note with my right hand, then Nicole does it differently. She takes that harmonic interval, the upper note of the harmonic interval with the right hand, and then the left hand does that 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3 descending. Assume it's triplet, triplet, triplet. But in fact, it's 1 and 2 and 3 and triplet. So should we try it?
Sure.
So look at the where I pencil in the where the marks is. treat that pencil mark as the first beat of every 3/4, then you end up having that rhythm at the end of that slideshow. One and three. So the secondo part sounds like this. Both of us needs to maintain very steady. It's very easy to fall apart. And then the last one. This is a common challenge in duet playing, is that you have unisons, and then you always hear splits. So what we do is we simplify it. So what we do, this is in triplets. So we just end up playing.
Thank you.
we neglected to mention it, but this is a new arrangement. By Brent Edstrom. It came out in 2014, and it caught our eye because it was designed for the more advanced student, but maybe not professional. And we decided that it was worth investigating, learning, and experiencing, because it is playable by advanced, even maybe late intermediate advanced students. It's so much fun, but it has its challenges, so I think it's a great learning opportunity. And we saw it and decided it would be worth investigating, doing a bit more work on.
Is there a version for solo piano?
Oh, there's more than, I think there's more than one, yeah. And it's
hair-raising,
yeah.
I've actually done a version for clarinet and piano.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. Well, there are all sorts of them.
Yeah.
Banjo octet, I believe, is out there.
Banjo octet, that I have.
I kid you not, a banjo octet. It's an old one.
Thank you.